July to go through the processes for next academic year, so that that hopefully does not happen again.
Any more questions on that? Thank you, Sally. It's good news overall, because we're now allowing that. If we can now move on to item 9, which is about the high needs at the end of August.
This is really, we produced a paper called Special Education Needs and Disability Funding. That's gone out of consultation to mainstream primary secondary schools and our special schools as well. And the idea of the paper was to really produce a common framework for schools with regards to exceptional needs funding that's open and transparent. So the paper looks at support in mainstream schools, looking at the graduated response for universal and targeted funding. And we anticipate, as the boards have, that the majority of children and young people with SEND, the funding that is in the mainstream school, will have the needs met and will be required in education and healthcare plan. We see the education healthcare plans predominantly for those children who are looking at specialist or special school provision. So within the universal funding, we feel that schools use that effectively, they'll be able to meet a wide range of needs. And then we have the targeted funding, the additional £6,000 that goes into schools' budget to really provide additionality support for those children and young people who need it. So those two budgets are looking at mainstream schools approximately having £10,000 for those pupils with SEND who require that additional funding. We regard that as schools receiving an additional 5 units of support without having to apply to the local authority for any additional funding. Now outside those children, there will be those children whose needs are higher and that funding doesn't meet their needs. So 3.4 covers the additional funding for early years. We have a small pot of money for early years that predominantly has supported early years settings, our private voluntary settings and some of our childcare providers. We've now extended that to also the mainstream schools who have 2 and 3 and 5 for that same level of funding as other year providers. So again, we've got a common formality for schools to do applications. We've then got 3.5 covers additional funding for mainstream primary and secondary schools through what we refer to as an individual pupil funding agreement. At the moment, we have an individual pupil funding agreement for children who have a diagnosis of autism or social communication difficulties. We're now going to roll out those IFAs for all areas of SEN as outlined in the code, so the schools will be able to apply for cognition and learning, social, emotional, mental health, communication, interaction, and sensory and physical needs. So the old healthcare plans and different streams of funding will now all come under an IFA under the 4 areas. So we're going to have an open, transparent process that's going to be very accessible to schools to apply for any additional funding. Through an IFA, schools can apply to the decision-making group at the local authority for an additional 7 units of support. Lying alongside this additional funding, the IFAs is a threshold document that's currently being produced
remain in Wirral in mainstream settings. So it's been quite unusual that we've got, I think it's 5 year people who can't put the first staff, whose school placement, whilst challenging, was holding, but it's their care placement. These are children who have either become looked after or their looked after placement was disrupted. So we are really starting to focus on this small group of particularly vulnerable children to look at how we can wrap services around them to keep them in mainstream settings and keep them local under our noses.
Any further comments on
back to Andrew again, really, that it says that it assumes that mainstream schools have been delegated the first 10,000, where actually for primary schools that's not 10,000 because the AUP isn't 4,000.
Thank you, Chair. I just clarify that element is not just the AUP, it's also all the other elements that count towards pupil funding. I think that will vary school by school. When you add all those up, then you do get nearer to the £4,000.
Any further questions on that then? Okay, thank you very much, Robert. No, that report. Move on to the next agenda item, which is Andrew, which is. Oh, no, sorry, I missed you. I've already told you what I've already missed.
Changes to the governing bodies, pupil assessments, and a national school funding formula, which I briefly mentioned earlier. In terms of future roles and responsibilities for councils, as set out in the white paper, there are three key areas. And they're clearly areas that require stewardship of councils across the whole school arrangements. So, school plays planning, and nationally, clearly, this is a significant issue with different features in different local authorities in terms of this will remain the ongoing responsibility of councils. And councils will continue to commission high needs places and develop provision and shape how we commission services to meet more vulnerable children's needs. And the final area, you've heard me in the past talk about championing children's needs and that being a really strong role in enshrined in regulation around the Directorate of Children's Services. But the white paper sets out that councils, in addition to championing children's needs, in fact I don't think they amplify that, but talk about championing parents and families' needs, providing information and advice, coordinating schools' ambitions and appeals, and I think correctly it's proposed this remains a central council function, and it's part of the process of stewarding fair access protocols across the whole system. These are often understandably areas that are contentious and being time consuming, and the funding to secure these responsibilities is yet to become firm as part of the national funding formula. I think the core responsibilities to set out as proposals in the white paper do particularly align with the three pledges that we have within the Children and Young People's Plan, that children are ready for school, the young people are ready for work and adulthood, and vulnerable children reach their full potential. I mean, what is clear that if the white paper comes to pass by way of legislation, then the responsibility for improving school standards to make schools good, continue on outstanding, continue to improve GCSE and A-level results, the results at key stages, will be an increasing focus for school leaders, their trust, but also place an emphasis on the strength of the partnership for us to work collaboratively and collectively to drive up standards and continue to meet the aspirations set out in our strategy. So what I've done is just provide some objective headlines of what's contained in the white paper. But as I said at the outset, this is trailing a fuller discussion at our meeting of the Schools Forum in July. Because as I said, there are discussions currently underway with the administration, senior leadership in the council to really confirm our position on the white paper and the approach that's been put forward by government.
Thank you, Julie. Any comments on that? Could I urge Julie, when you mentioned place planning in that you also think about the local authorities intentions of an additional 10,000 homes over the coming years, and that needs to be taken into account, and we're all conscious that the mentioning surplus and the school stock doesn't take that into consideration, should be considered. Any more? No, please. Andrew, I introduced you earlier because I was wrong, so your chance is now.
Thank you, Chair. The next set of papers follow the DfE's consultation on schools funding. In March, they issued two papers. The first, the proposals for a national funding forum for schools, and the second, their proposals around high needs funding. In both areas, what they're saying is that this is the first of two consultations. The first one now took largely about their outline proposals and thinking about what should look like. And then a second consultation, probably during the end of this term, possibly into the summer break, with more detail about what the implications are of some of their plans, particularly how it might affect schools. should areas be able to set an inner funding guarantee which is lower than minus 1.5% in order to move more quickly to whatever national funding programme needs. And you can see part of the consultation response, the view of the working group is very clear that no, that shouldn't be the case because dealing with an MFG minus 1.5% is particularly difficult without making it even worse by considering a reduction. Moving on to high needs, the proposals around high needs are slightly different. There's no plans for a high needs funding formula directly impacting on the required formulas for maintaining special schools. Instead, what the formula will do is it will move from a position where currently the allocation of funding is based on historic spend. It won't use significantly current levels of pupil numbers, but it will use instead what they call proxy indicators of need. So they're currently looking at proxies which take account of health and disability, low attainment, deprivation, and pupil numbers. But again, until we start to see the weightings that are attached to those areas, we won't really know what the implications are of the distribution of funding. The aim still to be announced is a formula for early years, and the department has said that formula and proposals around that should be available later in the year. So for now, what we've got is an initial consultation on what are the principles behind the formula. We've got some fairly clear steer about the changes that are going to be introduced and the timescale of those changes. And what will be promised is more details about what the individual implications are of those changes by the summer. The difficulty that departments are facing is the both the local elections and the EU elections. It is highly unlikely that any further consultation will be made before the EU referendum on the 24th of June. Thank you, Chair.
Have you got any questions for Andrew?
Andrew, you know I'm very concerned about have been PFI National Funding for a long time. So concerned that I went down to London in my holidays to have a meeting with Tom Goldman, who's in charge of National Funding, and asked him a direct question about PFI. If you actually read the National Funding consultation document, and the bit about the gap being put into school budgets direct, it doesn't actually say that, it says and or. And Tom was very clear that it is up to authority and the schools forum, whether it's and or, it's not fit to complain that a gap should be put to PFI schools. Can I then inform yet again the PFA contract is with the local authority, it is not with the 9 PFI schools?
Any further questions on that?
costs are unsustainable.